then we are moving to before we have the chance to mingle and sparkle our creativity for the afternoon session. We'll hear Georgi.
Of this quite intriguing event today. I will allow myself to talk in English so I could be able to reach as much as possible of the present people here. Yeah? So first of all, I'm an urban planner. I'm working for Fraunhofer, which is the European largest applied research institution. I'm working together with the Academy of Sciences in Sofia. And since recent times, I'm working as a representative of the Bulgarian government at the General Consulate in Munich, responsible for the economic issues. And today I was very intrigued by the different perspectives on the smart and knowledge cities. Some of them on the entrepreneurship, some of them on the integrated planning, all of these things which became very, like, I would say, hype in the recent years, of course, for some very good reasons. And there's one thing I cannot agree with you, Francesco, when you say that many cities nowadays are stupid. Cities or everywhere on this world, they emerged, they were created just by people. And they were not, they didn't start by building some houses. Every city on this world started from the roads. Every city became a crossroad of some roads. And the consequence of that, people understood, aha, it really makes sense to live here. So I can contact as much as possible of the people crossing over there. And they began to build buildings, and they began at some moment of time in the 20th century to overcomplicate the urban system by making it too large, concentrating a huge amount of population at one place. And by this making the mobility in the urban system really complicated. My presentation is focused on the urban air mobility, which is also an initiative of EIP-SCC, and I'm responsible for the region of Bulgaria for our activities. It's quite a fresh initiative, started about 1 year ago, where we already have more than 30 cities in among Europe. Let's begin now. So, as I began to explain, cities are something created by people. They are social systems created by people, which just have a physical dimension. And smart cities, what we are talking so much about today, of course, are driven also by information exchange and by native digital applications nowadays. Yeah? Everything in order to drive in the direction of the smart mobility on the one side, to make the life of people easier in the cities, to decrease the negative emissions. So the motto of our initiative is walk, ride, drive and fly. The first three things we used to do quite a lot in the recent decades, fly okay, in the recent 2 to 3 decades became quite common, and now we are trying, when we are looking at this cycle here, I don't know how to do that, it's too high. We know all of these kind of transportations, and finally we are coming to the new idea to overcome all these problems of the urban mobility by talking and doing an innovation on the field of urban air mobility. which means we are detaching ourselves from the two-dimensional mobility which we are experiencing nowadays. That's why we very often in the morning hear from someone, yeah, sorry, I'm so late, but I was in the traffic jam. And we are going to the third dimension using the air as a medium for transportation in our overpopulated cities. So why are we doing that? There are several already quite serious players on the market, already developed some technologies for urban air mobility, as you can see on this list, like Lilium, Volocopter, and of course Airbus. And it's all about this initiative to interface or to enable the urban air mobility by interrelating the different topics partially we were talking this morning about, and to interrelate different services into an entire mobility concept, which of course communicates with the current mobility concepts like car mobility and trains and so on. So of course, cities are in the focus of the whole thing, of the whole game that we are playing currently with a lot of different stakeholders among Europe and even outside. So cities always regulate the transportation infrastructure by themselves, and they also own it. They own and control the traffic and transport data, which we experience nowadays, and we are improving that also. And of course, smart cities are meant to have a digital infrastructure backbone, which seems to be not a very simple issue, but I hope we are going to manage it quite properly in every city. So we are aiming integrated mobility solutions, combining ground transportation and air, demonstrable benefits to citizens, for example, very short travel times, comfort and the social value, and of course socially and environmentally acceptable solutions, increasing the comfort level, decreasing the noise pollution. So how it works? We are having four stages in our process. Most of the cities, most of the front runner cities at our initiative have already completed these first two steps, where the first phase is the ending with the signing of the manifesto of intent for participation in this initiative. Which means that this city already has partners from the industries, from the research, from the technology fields of work, and then they're going towards demonstration projects. In the second phase that we are currently having, the cities are defining and preparing their demonstration projects, which step is finishing by signing the memorandum of understanding. And after that we have several other steps, but what is the most important is what we have up to now. The initiative started with the joining of Geneva to the team of cities, to the club of cities, let's say, after that followed by Hamburg, Ingolstadt, Ghent, and on the 26th of June this year, during the EIP-SCC annual assembly here in Sofia, we had the signing of Plovdiv also, after that of the city of Brussels, the region of Münster, and then Antwerpen, and several other ones. And of course, the demonstration project proposal is the core of the whole activity for this and next year, because it describes the envisaged strategy of every city on what it's intending to do on the urban air mobility and with whom and how. So we are not pushing the initiative. Every city is the initiator for itself of its own demonstration project, which of course is aiming not only to be just initiative and fancy, but to be innovative and fancy, is more going in the direction that every city should know why it's doing that, what is the business model or the group of business models standing behind this activity, so it can really make sense for the urban society. And as I already mentioned, we're talking about not just a drone demo project. What we are experiencing in many cities all around the world nowadays, we are talking about integrating the urban air mobility into the urban planning, which is quite a difficult issue when we think about all kinds of regulations on urban and building level. And of course, the core of the whole thing is the engagement of the citizens around this concept, the citizens' co-creation, and the social impact planning, and so on. And of course, the raising of investments in order to enable this concept to get into the reality in these particular cities. On the 19th of October, we had the launch of the European Network of Use-Based Demonstrators, which are already 12 cities. 12 demonstrators, 17 cities or regions. It was in Antwerpen, and these are the cities which already have signed the Memorandum of Understanding and go the further step already in the direction of direct investments and activities on the field of urban air mobility demonstration. And the day after tomorrow, we are having our first general forum together with EASA in the framework of the Amsterdam Drone Week, where the frontrunner cities of the initiative will present their current activities and also possibilities for interrelation of activities between the different cities. So it's all about to innovate and to invest in the urban air mobility. And in order to show you that we are having quite a practical activity and network, I would like to invite one partner from the Bulgarian Academy of Sciences, Professor Sofia, for 1 minute or for 2 minutes to present you what's happening in the area of the region of Plovdiv, where we're talking about not just an urban transportation system, we are talking about a regional transportation system. Because in Francesco's presentation, it was very nice presented the growth of the cities, yeah? But we should also say that this growth is not just because the cities are attracting so many people inside, but because the agglomerations of the cities are getting larger in the recent years and decades. So we are talking a lot about the regional transportation and the overcoming of the challenges caused by it. So, Professor Zafirov, please present the activities of Plovdiv. I don't know. Yeah, thank you.
Тази инициатива за градска авиационна мобилност. Така. Състоянието на градската мобилност е известно на всички. Колкото повече коли, толкова повече задръствания, толкова по-увеличено време за пътуване. В същото време градската мобилност, градовете нарастват за разлика от живеещите в районите извън градовете. Ето, това мисля, че ще ни очаква в сегашното и близкото бъдеще. Все повече и повече коли, разширяване, все повече коли ще се купуват и ще се стигне до една ситуация с околната среда, която сега ще ни изглежда много приятна, много добра. Когато говорим за интелигентни градове, един от стълбовете, които са основните стълбове за интелигентни градове, това е градската конкурентност. Ето, не само на хора, и на отделни стоки. Така ли си представяме превоза на хора в градски условия? Трябва да кажа, че това е един от първите опити за това да се реши някакво превозване на хора в една среда, в която е градска среда. Не. Усилено се работи, вече има няколко успешни стартирания на проекти, които са за превоз в градски условия на пътници. И ето вижте, това е една от предишната беше също на Airbus, това е също идея на Airbus за превоз на пътници, която има много добри попадения и вероятно в тази посока ще се движи развитието. Какво е интересното в нея? Превозното средство се състои от три модула, като този модул е автономен автомобил, този модул е капсула за пътници и този модул е за превоз по въздуха. Изведнъж облекчаваме задачата на конструкторите и на хората, които ще ползват тези превозни средства, защото няма нужда въздушният модул да носи едно шаси наземно, в същото време няма защо при движение по пътищата въздушния модул да се чудим как да го скатаем, за да не пречим и да имаме по-малко обем за пътуването. Изискванията са към един такъв летателен апарат, той да бъде вертикално излетащ и кацащ. Емисиите му да бъдат нулеви, продължителността да полета поне за сега над час се изисква, бързо зареждане да има, персонален летателен апарат. Но ще се спра да обясня малко по-подробно. Ако вие искате да си купите своя летателен апарат, вероятно ще бъде доста скъпо. В същото време, услугите, които ще се предоставят с такива летателни апарати, ще бъдат по-евтини, отколкото притежаването на личен летателен апарат, лично превозно средство, говорим за автомобил. С базата на това, че това се ползва за кратко време, на доста големи разстояния може да се пътува, с много малък разход на енергия, като се планира изцяло електрически да бъдат тези летателни апарати. Комфорта, който се изисква в тази капсула, трябва да бъде близък до този в офиса или в дома, с всичките свързаности, условия, економични и така нататък. Градската среда ще изисква едно по-различно развитие при наличието на един такъв транспорт и отначало това се планира да започне по-етапно от точка до точка превозване, като постепенно все повече и повече точки ще се създават в градски условия, в региона и ще се развива този транспорт. Няма отутре, ако намерим превозно средство, да можем да започнем да използваме такъв транспорт. И управлението на въздушното движение е един от проблемите. В момента програма СЕЗАР на Европейската комисия разработва движението на големите самолети в въздушното пространство по четирите траектории, където ще отпаднат сегашните ешалони и коридори. Ето как би изглеждало организационната система на България, това е стратегията за развитие. И виждаме, че имаме едно такова развитие, както беше показано, като децентрализирано. Но така или иначе, пътуването е доста трудно. И ето как би изглеждало една 45-минутна транспортна достъпност при използването на въздушни превозни средства. Ето виждате какви разстояния ние можем за 45 минути да преминем и спокойно хората от тези градове да работят в София или защо не е обратно. Или да живеят някъде в този целия регион, да си имат комфорт, комфортни условия, да не се притесняват от това, че няма пространство. За тях ето виждате даже от западните покрайни ние можем да ползваме хора. Това изведнъж решаваме въпроси, свързани с това, че работната ръка може да бъде много по-мобилна от сега съществуващото положение. Трябва един нов подход при развитието, планирането развитието. Сегашните прогнози, които правим, са на база в повечето случаи на една историческа информация. Каква ще е историческата информация за въздушни превози в градовете? Бихте ли ми казали в този момент? Имаме ли такава информация? Ежедневно предвиждаме с въздушни превозни средства в градовете, които могат да си позволят изключителни позиции, които имат хората. В същото време ние трябва да минем на един нов инструмент, foresight analysis, в който ние да се представим след няколко години или след известно време какво искаме да бъде даден град. Да видим къде са нещата, които е трудно да изпълним и да се насочат усилията и на политици, и на бизнесмени към решаване на тези проблеми и тогава да се направи пътна карта, за да се види в какви граници това нещо може да се реализира. Един от основните аргументи на противниците на въздушната мобилност, градската въздушна мобилност е този, че това няма да стане това столетие. Следващото десетилетие ще има такива превозни средства и такъв транспорт. Не само в най-развитите градове. В това съм сигурен, защото транспортните средства вече наистина стигнаха много. Остава да се решава въпросът на управлението на въздушното движение. В начало не трябва някаква сериозна инфраструктура за реализирането на начало на тези полети. Благодаря ви за вниманието. Максимално кратко се старах да бъдам.
That what we are talking about is not a science fiction. We are a big team of planners and aircraft engineers, and we are already working with Airbus and with Audi, for example, on a project in Ingolstadt in Germany. So everything what you can see and hear, what you heard in the last 20 minutes, is something what will become reality in the next 5 years. Yeah. So and the technology for it already exists. We are just in the face of preparing the implementation in the urban environment, which is quite a challenging topic. So, thank you for your attention.
Thank you everyone for sharing with us your valuable knowledge and experience and good practices. I hope we all got a spark of creativity and energy. Now I would like to offer you to go outside and take your questions to our panel if you all agree, so we can go into a more creative environment and have some coffee outside. And after the break, we proceed with the second panel. Thank you.